discrete log computations over fq, where q is p to the power n. N is a integer, a positive integer greater than or equal to 1. Now, this is the standard sub-exponential expression. And depending on the value of a, the fields are characterized into basically four types. Small, if a is less than or equal to 1/3, medium, a between 1/3 and 2/3. The boundary case is a is 2/3, and large characteristic, a is greater than 2/3. So the case that Nadia referred to is essentially the large characteristic case. She was talking about in the context of n equals to 1. N greater than 1 becomes important in the context of pairings. So if you're looking at pairings, then n equals 12, for example, is a popular choice. Okay, so there has been a tremendous progress in discrete log computation over finite fields. In the small characteristics case, the function field sieve algorithm has led to a quasi polynomial time algorithm. And the medium prime case, the boundary case, well, large prime case, not so much, but more specifically, the medium prime case, which is of interest in the context of pairings, this has received a certain amount of interest. And this interest started from a paper by Barbalisky et al. Eurocrypt 2015, followed by a paper at last AsiaCrypt, and then this Eurocrypt, Crypto, and so on. And it's continuing. I'll tell you how it's continuing. So this is one slide overview of the number field sieve algorithm. There are two polynomials. You need to choose two polynomials, f and g, with integer coefficients, such that they have a common irreducible factor, phi x, of degree n, over the field fp. And then this is the standard way from zx you go to fpm. Well, alpha and beta are roots of fx and gx, and m is a root of phi x. So you can, I mean, there is a homomorphism this way and a homomorphism this way. And then you get, you split, a kind of split ideals. Okay, so you have to talk about ideals. So number fields are defined by f and g, and then you work in the ring of integers of these number fields. The factor basis consists of prime ideals whose norms are at most some pre-specified bound B. How to choose this bound, that becomes part of the algorithm. The main thing, okay, so how, yeah. So how do you actually collect relations? Relations are relations among the factor basis elements. One chooses polynomials phi x of degrees at most t minus 1. T is commonly taken to be 2, so linear polynomials. And if it turns out that these two principal ideals are both smooth over the factor basis, then you obtain a relation. So the details of this factorization, etc., those are not really very relevant for this talk. What is important is that the norm of this ideal is the resultant of f and phi. And this fact, for ensuring smoothness of this ideal, it is sufficient that this resultant is B smooth. That's the most important thing. And I mean, in the context of our term, I'm not saying that's the most important thing for NFS. In the context of our term, this is the most important thing. And the known bounds on, known results on resultant show that the resultants of F and phi are essentially of this type. So they are, if T is fixed, they are controlled by the size of the coefficients of F and G and their degrees. So the lower these values are, the lower the resultants are. So using this, Barbalisky et al. At Eurocrypt last year, they derived asymptotic complexities. In the medium prime case, they achieved complexity where the second constant in the sub-exponential expression is 96 by 9 to the power 1/3. For the boundary case, this is 48 by 9. And large prime case, this is 64 by 9. So you can see that it's somewhat arbitrary that why in the boundary case this is small, whereas in the medium prime case this is the largest. So one way of trying to improve the complexity of the medium prime case is to try and see whether this complexity can be achieved even in the medium prime case. So kind of reduce the medium prime case to the boundary case. And for that, this tower number field sieve algorithm can be used. This was proposed a long time back, analyzed fully at last AsiaCrypt, and then there was a at this crypto, there was this paper by Kim and Barbalescu. So the idea is that n here needs to be composite, so eta into kappa, and q is p to the power eta. So you look at this this finite field, fp to the n, as fq to the power kappa, where q is p to the power eta. So you look at a tower field. So first extension by degree eta, and then a degree kappa extension. The main idea is that, well, suppose p is falls in the medium prime case, so a is small. Now, if it turns out that q is p to the power eta, q is large enough such that q can be written as lq two-third, so this shouldn't be q, cp, but essentially lq two-third, then you can apply the boundary case algorithm to q, pretending it's a prime. I mean, it's not really a prime. The algebra won't go through, but the complexity estimates goes through. So you can achieve the complexity for the boundary case for the medium prime case. So that is the main crux. And this variant of TNFS that was proposed by Kim Barbalescu, they called it the XTNFS. Now, in this setting, so we want to work over a tower field. So first you have to get a degree eta extension. And that is done by choosing a polynomial Hz of degree eta. And Hz is irreducible over Fp, and its coefficients are small. So that gives you a degree eta extension. And then you want to do a degree kappa extension over this one. And similarly, one defines this ring R. And so previously, where fx and gx in zx, these can ideally be in rx. Now, in Kim Barbalescu setting, they considered fx and gx also over zx. Of course, zx is a subset of rx, so they are still in rx, but ideally speaking, you could also put them in rx. And you need both to be reducible over R, and this GCD is a degree kappa. So this is essentially the setting. Their method had a limitation. So this phi x is of degree kappa and is irreducible over fp to the power eta. So this is a polynomial in fp, which is irreducible over fp to the power eta. This requires that kappa and eta are coprime. So that means it applies to composite non-prime power n, such as 6, 3 into 2, 12, 3 into 4, and so on, but cannot be applied to composite prime power n, such as 4, 8, 9, and 16. When it does apply, they improve this complexity of estimate, so reduce 96 by 9 to 48 by 9. So our first goal was to try and see whether it can also be applied to composite prime power. So we proposed a new polynomial selection method, introduced several parameters. So this eta kappa remains the same as before. We introduce a parameter D. I mean, the reason for doing this is that we can see all the previous polynomial selection algorithms as special cases of this algorithm. So that's one of the reasons why we extended the Kim Barbalescu method by these parameters. And also we got certain asymptotic improvement, but that's not the end of the story. Anyway, so we introduce a divisor of kappa and R, which is it's greater than or equal to k, which is kappa by d, and lambda is 1 by n. So now the polynomial selection actually proceeds via two steps, or random trials do some random trials to find fx, gx, and phi x, where fx and gx are in rx. Note that we no longer want fx and gx to be in zx. They could be in that middle ring, and irreducible over R, and phi x, the middle field. Okay, so we will be using the LLL algorithm. This was first proposed by Julersier and then extended to the generalized Julersier method by Barbalescu et al. At last Eurocrit. We will be using that. And so for doing that, I need to describe some slight notation. So given any polynomial AX in RX, so that it will look of this type. So these are polynomials in Z. And you can write this polynomial as a vector, essentially write out all of these as vectors. Now these will, these has coefficients only up to lambda minus 1, the rest are 0, and lambda is either 1 or eta. Okay, now this vector, using this vector, one can define this matrix MAR. R is this integer that is a parameter to the algorithm. So this is the diagonal matrix, I mean lower triangular diagonal matrix. This is just the diagonal matrix. So we are defining a lower triangular matrix. This is the diagonal matrix. This is the vector A with 1 on the diagonal. And then again a diagonal matrix and shift A by lambda and 1 on the diagonal and so on. So we saw, I mean, the intuition behind defining this matrix, that I cannot explain right now. But this works. The determinant is important because we'd be getting bounds on the coefficients of polynomial written by this matrix. So the determinant turns out to be this. So we apply the LLL algorithm to this matrix, and the first row is written in this fashion, which is then again recast into polynomial form as follows in this form. So this forms the B0Z, this forms B1Z, and so on. And the coefficients of B from known results on the LLL algorithm can be shown to be Q to the power epsilon by N, where epsilon is this quantity. And this is the polynomial we'll write as, and given A, the original polynomial A, and an integer R, we'll write this polynomial BX as LLL MAR. Now I describe the two steps of the random trials. The first step is to choose a monic polynomial, A1X, in RX. So the coefficients can be from this Z by H. Degree A1 is R plus 1, A1 is irreducible over R, and it has coefficients. Coefficient polynomials are small enough, but large enough also so that you can actually choose such a polynomial. And over fp to the eta, a1x has an irreducible factor, a2x of degree k, such that all coefficient polynomials of atx have degree at most lambda minus 1. Okay, so that may sound complicated, but anyway, that can be done. And then one chooses monic polynomial C0x and C1x with small integer coefficients. So we are now for C0x and C1x, we are taking them to integer coefficients. This can be relaxed, and we have done that relaxation later, but not in this paper. So I won't talk about that. And then one can define F as this resultant of A1y. So A1, note that this is a polynomial whose coefficients are polynomials in Z. These are C0x and C1x, these are polynomials whose coefficients are integers, but you can define the resultants. And I mean, this is the way you define this resultant and keep on doing these random trials until you obtain this condition, the terminating condition, that F and G are irreducible over R, and phi, which is the GCD of F and G, it will turn out to be the GCD of F and G, is irreducible over Fp to the eta. So the, I mean, based on this now, whether this terminates, et cetera, I mean, you don't have a theoretical proof. Nobody in this polynomial selection world proves termination, but it does work. I mean, we have experimented, and we have seen that you can actually get it within a few trials. But of course, that's a theoretical question, whether it actually does terminate. So that kind of analysis does not seem to be very important at this point of time. Okay, so the degree F is D into R plus 1 and so on. So these features can be shown. The main thing is the norms can be shown to be this quantity. I mean, this. So we can derive norms of this type. Now, once you have the norms, the asymptotic complexity is completely defined by the norms because, as I mentioned, the smoothness probability is just the probability that it's heuristically taken to be the probability that an integer of this size is B smooth. And from that, one derives the asymptotic complexity. Once you have the norms, there is a very routine kind of calculation which will show you the actual complexity. Okay, so now I'll try to explain why this subsumes the previously known algorithms. If you take eta equals to 1, then you don't really have the tower. So this reduces to NFS, and then it results in the algorithm A that we had proposed at this zero trip, and which in turn also subsumes the previous algorithm of Barbelescu et al. At Euro trip 2015. Now, if you take eta greater than 1 and lambda equals to 1, then this condition forces phi x, Well, the irreducibility of phi x over f p to the power eta will require this GCD eta kappa equals to 1. And then special cases of this setting would be the Kim-Barbalescu algorithm proposed at this script. The new case arises when lambda is eta and both are greater than 1. And in this case, this phi x is kind of properly in that middle field. So you don't really require this condition GCD eta kappa equals 1. So that means now you can apply the algorithm for all composite n instead just of, whereas previously it could only be applied to composite non-prime power n. And that's the complicated looking theorem that we'll get. So I won't try to explain this theorem. I'll just mention that the runtime can be seen as this LQ132CB, where CB is given by this expression, this RKT. T is this degree. Well, t minus 1 is the degree of the sieving polynomials. And c theta is cp into c eta, where eta can be written in this fashion. So one interest, this captures the entire complexity of the algorithm. It seems to be of interest that you find the minimum possible value of that. That minimum possible value will not be achieved for all primes, but nevertheless try to find the minimum possible value. So to do that, one needs to minimize the CB with respect to C theta, and that's a very standard derivative and so on. One can show that the minimum is achieved for T equals 2. In the case lambda is 1, we obtain this, and essentially you get this value 48 by 9 to the power 1/3, which is the Kim-Barbalescu case. And when lambda is eta greater than 1, then the minimum is attained. Well, you have to choose R, K, and kappa to be same, and the minimum value turns out to be this. So for eta equals 2, the minimum is 64 by 9. Now previously this was 96 by 9. This gets reduced to 64 by 9. Eta is 3, well, it keeps on slightly increasing. So we do not achieve, in this paper, we could not achieve this 48 by 9 to the power 1/3 for composite prime power n. So for example, 4, 8, 9, 25, and so on. And this is shown by this plot. Well, this is the plot for this lambda equals 1. So essentially, this is not the Kim-Barbalescu complexity is this one, but this is C theta. So as C theta increases, it's not that you always get this minimum complexity. It's a more kind of complex thing. These correspond to different values of R. And then you have this other plot. So lambda equals 2. So you have this lambda equals 3. So this kind of keeps on increasing a little. So that is what we achieved. But as I mentioned, this is a continuing story. So this is not the end of the story. We have just one sentence in that complete story. Subsequent to our work, in fact, while this paper was in submission to AsiaCrib, it was improved by Jiang and Kim, who showed how to achieve complexity 48 by 9 to the power 1/3 for all composites. So before it became published, the results become obsolete, and it was very kind of the reviewers to accept the paper. But anyway, at the time of submission, we didn't know that. I don't think this paper was also available. And subsequent to their work, we generalized their algorithm. So this entire structure that we had put on the Kim-Barbalescu work, we could see that, we had missed something. And I really rue the fact that I missed it. But anyway, we missed it. But we could see that once the Jiang Kim paper was there, the entire structure that we had put on the Kim-Barbalescu thing, we could also put on the Jiang Kim paper. And then we have a general polynomial selection method. To that, we did add a concrete analysis. But there are still, I don't know if somebody else, as I said, we have just added one small sentence, but others are probably working on it, maybe getting better algorithms. But this does have consequences to actual choice of prime sizes for pairings. And up to this work, how to choose group sizes? Well, I discussed that last week at MyCrib. So we have a paper on that. It's also on ePrint by Alfred Meneges, myself, and Shashank. We did a concrete analysis and tried to show, if you take only this much into account, then what should be your group sizes? Okay, so thank you for your kind attention.
Are there any questions? So I have some to get things going. So when you think of pairings, actually my impression was that pairing is also kind of a boundary case corresponding to exactly one third, right? Because you have to balance the complexity of the elliptic curve discrete log, which is exponential, and the large field and the extension field or discrete log, and so you're exactly on the boundary between small prime and medium prime case, but you can't use the function field sieve because your base field is too large anyway. So in that, so do we really know the complexity of the pairing situation?
Well, do you really know is a difficult question to answer. Now, based on this existing ADAX, we did a concrete analysis. That much I can say. But we came up with some conservative estimates of group sizes, which we believe will give you security, say, at the 128-bit or the 192-bit levels. So maybe if you use that, now if somebody comes up with an algorithm which is better, okay, so the point that you raised, so you have to balance this. Well, I wouldn't say you have to balance it. You have to ensure that it's secure against both kinds of attacks. So while doing that, it may turn out, and it does turn out, like in the previously in the baryonic, for the baryonic curves, what used to happen was that it kind of balanced things very same. In this 128-bit security level, you get 256-bit primes, and then 3072-bit p to the power n is 12. And then it was kind of balanced against both attacks. But that no longer holds. At least it doesn't hold for the Barrett-Henry case. You have to increase your P. By increasing your P, you get some additional row security, which doesn't help you against this NFS kind of thing. So that balance is lost in the Barrett-Henry case, but not in all the cases.
Thank you. So any other question? So I have one more, if you don't mind. So you mentioned using LLL for polynomial selection. So since we have a sub-exponential algorithm anyway, we could use, say, a BKZ with a relatively large block size. Does it change anything for the complexity?
LLL is, the reason we used LLL is that we know these estimates on the coefficient sizes of the vector written by LLL. Now, if you use the BKZ, I don't know, I haven't thought about it. The other reason is LLL is very easily implemented in Magma. I mean, it's there in Magma, you just run it, and you can get the examples. But also, we need to do this asymptotic analysis. So for the theoretical analysis, I know that this is the vector, shortest vector written by the LLL algorithm. Well, you have bounds on the L infinity norms. So if there are corresponding bounds or better bounds by other algorithms, you can certainly use that. And that may improve complexity, I don't know. But I haven't seen any work on that. Maybe
okay.
There is something there.
So if there are no more questions, let's thank the speaker again. The second talk of the session is about the security of supersingular isogenic cryptosystem. It's a paper by Stephen Galbraith, Christophe Petit, Barak Chani, and Jan Botti, and Jan will give the talk.